Okay, first up I'd like to introduce Stephen O'Brien and Ross Morrow. Stephen is a PhD student in sociology. His current research interests include health, social movements and political history. And Ross, who I understand gave a very interesting paper at the River Seminar Series this semester on the killing of Osama bin Laden. Ross teaches social theory at the University of Sydney and interdisciplinary social science at UTS. He has teaching and research interests in social and political theory, social activism, and social change.
Well, today's take focus on the modular draft plan on contemplating research project on social activism in Newcastle, 1970 to 1910. We've proposed this period because it represents a 40-year time span that more or less corresponds to the proposed research participants' own political lives. These years provide a reference from the high point of the Vietnam War movement to last year when Afghanistan war was raging. As we tend to interview people from about 70 years old to under 30, this takes us back about 40 years when the oldest of our proposed respondents is more or less the same age as one of the young activists that we will interview. I said the more person today would have been 30th in 1970. So it's not quite two generations, but certainly much more than one generation. However, we don't want to be too arbitrary about dates. Respondents may want to recollect people and events from a much earlier time, perhaps places and people and demonstrations, rallies that may have influenced the people that influenced our respondents. So our panel today was going to just focus on the main research questions of nationale and our plan, research design and methodology. So I guess the main research questions are, we've got five of them, so I'll just briefly refer to each one. Motivations, why do people become socialists? Different reasons. It might be something that's happening down the end of the street, and it might be liberation theology, or in fact the influence perhaps of some of the people that we heard today in the next generation. It could be an event that's happening overseas, sold out, it was East Timor, for example, or the Vietnam War, as I mentioned. And the other question is, what do people develop an activist career, so to speak, using it as a sociological concept, which refers to a sequence of roles which individuals move during their lives. Here we're referring to their political lives. It includes both different stages in which individuals become political activists and a subjective understanding and interpretation of these stages. So what's the nature and significance of activists? What is the nature and significance of Newcastle for socialist activism? Previous discussion, we touched on the whole issue of the affluence of the working class, or the other issues that might be separate, or supposed that may be regarded as separate to the interests of the working class, or different ideas. I mean, different contentions between middle class and working class. I mean, how does that play out in Newcastle? Is socialist activism in Newcastle a product of the working class, the union traditions, or has it evolved these days? The product of something else, but apparently don't have any answer for that, but it will be an issue that we that may come out in the data. How have socialist activists in Newcastle made a difference to people's lives with their particular campaigns? One that just brings to mind that maybe come out is, for example, I know the Jobs for Women campaign that was led by socialists in Newcastle in the early 80s, and that actually took on BHP and women on the right to work in the steel industry and needed to have wider ramifications. That's perhaps an issue that may come out. Related to the research question, How do socialist activists ensure that the tradition of activism continues in the future? It's a question of perpetuation or sustainability of activists. What techniques they use, what's the training or team approaches, or how do people make way for new leaders, for new leaders, younger leaders? So the rationale really behind, based on those five basic research questions, what are the main reasons that's the rationale? Okay. Well, pretty much all to ask why people become activists, what their campaigns are, how they pass on their activist skills to new generations of activists. To fill some of the gaps in the literature about the history of the left, and in particular socialist politics in Newcastle, we've heard a number of presentations today. I think from what we haven't really heard is a bit about the environment of activists and the younger generation of those, but it hasn't been, based on today, and also I've been reading on the literature, it hasn't been a lot of work that's been done about contemporary social events that have stayed in the last 20 years. Also, to help reclaim for the working class itself, perhaps some of the oft-forgotten history of working class resistance to oppression, exploitation, and marginalisation. And I think another rationale is to provide information about early working class struggles that might prove useful to contemporary activists in their own campaigns. It's very interesting to hear Ross's presentation, for example, about silk. I personally haven't heard of that. I have other examples of previous struggles that our participants may refer to that they can help to bring them out of forgotten memory. At this stage, I'll hand over to Ross.
Okay, thanks, Stephen. So, the next part of the paper is really a little bit about the research design and methodology. And as Stephen said, we're in the early stages of doing the research, so this is really our plan and how we're going to do it and what we're going to do. And the first thing is, in terms of the empirical research, we're going to have what's called a purposive sample of six Newcastle socialist activists. And a purposive sample, for people who are not familiar with it, is a non-random form of sample. The aim of this form of sampling is essentially to help us understand in depth people's experiences, people's viewpoints, people's stories about activism. We're not trying to find a representative sample of people that we can generalise from. With a purposive sample, it means that you have a purpose when you select the people who will be in the study, and the purpose has got to do with your research questions and what it is that you want to know, because obviously you've got to select people who can give you the sort of information that you need to answer your research questions. Another thing that we need to sort out conceptually in the paper is we need to have some kind of a working definition of socialism if we're dealing with the issue of socialist activists. And to get a kind of a broad definition, I found this one from the British Marxist writer Ralph Miliband, very useful. He wrote in his book Socialism in a Skeptical Age that the world of socialism has always been one of extreme diversity, bitter divisions, enduring feuds. But there are certain core propositions which have attracted sufficient acceptance for most socialists to be legitimately taken to define the meaning of socialism. And he lists these in terms of three core propositions. The first one is a commitment to a very far-reaching form of democracy that goes beyond the typical constraints and limitations of capitalist democracy, because capitalist societies typically limit democracy in order to reduce the threat that it can pose to power and privilege within society. The second core proposition of socialism he talks about is a commitment to egalitarianism. That means an end to class inequality and an end to other major forms of structural inequality in society, so that there can be a much more egalitarian distribution of resources and opportunities for people. And the third key proposition that he talks about is socialisation of a major part of the economy. Sometimes this is talked about in terms of the commanding heights of the economy. And this is really about breaking the concentration of private economic and political power in society. It's about trying to reorient the economy and society away from the self-extension of capital toward meeting people's needs and toward meeting the needs of the environment. And it's also about creating the kinds of conditions in which egalitarianism and democracy can flourish, because it's difficult for those things to flourish where you have concentrated private ownership of wealth and society. And so for us, socialist activists will be people that have got a commitment to these sort of core propositions, and they may also self-identify as socialist activists and or be members of socialist organisations. So our start is really with the commitment to the principles of socialism, because in terms of self-definitions, there's a whole range of different ways that people can label themselves. And some people who are actually committed to socialist principles may not use that label about themselves. Similarly, there may be people committed to socialist principles who are not members of explicitly designated socialist organisations. So we want to recognise that possibility, although in likelihood, it will be that with the people that we're looking to recruit, that some or all may well also designate themselves as socialists and have that sort of explicit membership. The other conceptual, or really two other conceptual issues we have to deal with. One is about an activist. So what I've suggested here is that the term activist means that participants in our study have had a history of taking action in pursuit of a cause. And that might be anything from writing letters into the newspaper, to giving public speeches, to being involved in rallies, protests, forms of direct action and civil disobedience. And we want people who haven't just done this once or who just do it occasionally, but we want people that have done this consistently or regularly over time. And again, our focus is on the practice of what people do. And again, people may or may not label themselves as activists. They might have other terms that they use for themselves. They might call themselves advocates or community organisers. There's a whole range of ways that people can describe themselves, but we want to focus on what they actually do. And the other conceptual issue that we have to sort out is the term radical, which of course is what radical Newcastle is all about. And so we know that radicalism and the history of the term radical is a complicated one, problematic, and shifts in discourse. It's used differently by different groups. There can be liberals who call themselves radicals. There can be members of the new right, conservatives or neoconservatives, neoliberals who call themselves radical. So radical doesn't necessarily equal a socialist or a leftist politics. But our paper and our research project is about socialist radicals, the other kinds. And so we see this in terms of group, the root branch change to capitalist society. And we are activists, we're intending to recruit different generations, at least two generations. So we look at both current and past experience and draw some conclusions of those different experiences and perhaps some comparisons. And the last thing is that we need people who have either been long-term residents of Newcastle or residents who have been involved in activist campaigns here of one kind or another. And we need those people for our study participants. So just to finish off, I'll hand back to Stephen for the last part of our research methodology.
Thanks, Ross. As I mentioned, we've done a reasonably extensive literature review just to identify possible sources and documentation with regards to socialist activists in Newcastle. Taking on board the previous presentation, meaning Newcastle in the broader sense, strict geographical delineation. But also the data collection, as I mentioned in the literature review, in depth interviews. What about those? That they'll be semi-structured interviews, really, that they'll give us a mixture of highly structured interviews that are used in survey research and the unstructured interviews that resemble
conversation. You need a new guide that topics and questions, if not, it's a basic outline of the show that we've indicated. But the order, of course, will vary a bit, so that the interviewers can probe for more information when it seems relevant. And also that the respondents have more freedom to answer in their own terms, and if they're answering, giving yes or no to a specific questionnaire, for example. Semi-structured interviews can be used because they also they allow comparability between interviewees and responses, and also enable the analysts to have some flexibility in interviewing, in investigating specific issues. So, that in conjunction with the, as I said, the literature review, which we'll be continuing revising and looking out for new material.